Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in the Scottish Parliament's fifth session. Could I ask everyone in the room to switch off their mobile phones as they can interfere with the sound system. We have apologies from Donald Cameron this morning, who's slightly delayed. I'll not tell you why. Well, I will. His daughter's locked the car keys in the car. So just smile when he comes in. The first item on our agenda is evidence on the social and community care workforce. Before we begin, I would like to note that the committee met with frontline social and community care staff earlier this morning, and I would like to thank them for taking time out of their day to come and meet with us and tell us their experiences working in the sector. It was a very informative and helpful morning. I don't know if any of my colleagues would like to very briefly comment on the meeting this morning.
They were very forthright with their views, and they were very illuminating as to the issues they face.
Claire?
I'd just like to put on record my thanks to the staff who did come along this morning. I thought they were very frank with us, very open and honest with us, and they really to be congratulated for coming along and representing their workforce.
Okay. It was a very good session this morning. We now move on to our evidence session on the social and community care workforce. My name is Neil Findlay. I'm the chair of the Health and Sport Committee. I'm going to ask people to introduce themselves round the table. So, maybe Claire first.
Hi, I'm Claire Hawkey. I'm the deputy convener of the Health and Sport Committee.
Hello, I'm Jim Fordyce. I'm the managing director of a company called Hazelhead Home Care, who provide care at home services.
My name is Tom Arthur. I'm an MSP for Renfrewshire South.
Good morning, I'm Miles Briggs. I'm MSP for Lothian and a member of the committee.
I'm Donald McCaskill. I'm the chief executive of Scottish Care, which is a national membership organisation of providers of older people's care and support.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alex
Cole Hamilton. I'm MSP for Edinburgh West End.
Good morning, I'm Dave Watson. I'm the Head of Policy and Public Affairs at Unison Scotland. We represent care staff.
Morning, I'm Richard Lyle. I'm MSP for Uddingston and Belsall.
I'm Nikki Connor. I'm Associate Director of Nursing within the Health and Social Care Partnership in Fife.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
Hello, Annie Gunner-Logan. I'm from CCPS, the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland, which is the membership association for third or voluntary sector providers. I'm also a non-executive director of the Scottish Government, but I'm not here in that capacity today. And for the record, I'm a Unison member.
My name is Marie Todd, and I'm an MSP for the Highland and Island region.
My name is Ian Ramsey. I'm from the Aberdeenshire Health and Social Care Partnership.
Good morning. I'm Colin Smith. I'm an MSP for the South of Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Anna Fowley. I'm the Chief Exec of the Scottish Social Services Council. So we are the regulator for the social care and social work workforce, and also the lead for workforce development for that sector.
Hi, I'm Ivan McKee. I'm the MSP for Glasgow Proven.
Okay, thanks very much, folks. We want this to be a lively, interactive session rather than a kind of formal evidence session like we usually have. So we're kind of happy for people to just jump in. But we have about 75 minutes for our session. Brief contributions would be helpful, and not everyone needs to contribute on every topic. So for the committee members, if they want to indicate kind of if we want to move on to another topic, that would be helpful. So Alison, do you want to kick off?
Yes, thank you, convener. I think it's fair to say we all learned a lot this morning, hearing direct from those who are working in the delivery of care in our communities. And I think workforce planning is clearly an issue. I heard from one worker who had undertaken 31 visits to different people on Sunday. Clearly, a fairly hefty workload. And I heard a lot of 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. shifts. There was a feeling among some organisations that this was due to lack of staff. Lots of overtime required, and clearly a very responsible task. So I'd just like to ask what the main barriers are to effective planning of this workforce, because it certainly seems that there are several, and I'm not sure who to direct that question to in the first instance, Convener.
Who would like to jump in? Dave Watson's never been shy in his life.
Put him forward, yeah.
Workforce planning within what you describe is something that we look at often. What we particularly do specifically, you're talking about Sunday there, and it's something we see quite a lot. What we do personally as an organisation, our full-time workers work 3 out of 4 weekends. Nearly every other organisation we come across work 1 in every 2 weekends. I just cannot see how at the weekends it's possible to do that. So that's why we've always went 3 and 4 to make sure that we'll get the same number of workforce throughout the week. That's the type of thing that we look at, particularly as an organisation.
Fair amount too that a lot of organisations are relying on agency workers, which obviously has an impact on continuity of care, which can be quite distressing sometimes, perhaps for those who have dementia. I probably left this morning's session thinking we don't have enough people working in care, and also that there was a variety of training on offer for those who were working in the field.
The use of agency staff is a matter of considerable concern for many of our members, and sometimes agency staff are helpful during transition periods at holiday or relief, but certainly, and this is particularly the case with regards to the use of agency staff to fill nursing posts, we have profound concerns that the lack of the continuity of care, particularly as you've highlighted with somebody who may be living with dementia, that continuity is fundamentally important. Now, organisations do not want to use agency staff, not least because they are considerably more expensive. I heard of one provider last week who paid £800 an hour, £800 a night, sorry. It's bad enough, but not that bad. £800 a night for a nursing shift. Now, that is not a good business model. It doesn't give continuity. It's not good for colleagues to see somebody being brought in. The individual brought in on a short-term basis doesn't know the individuals that they're supporting. We have a critical shortage in some elements of social care and nursing staff. That's all bound up with our ability to recruit and to retain staff, which we are not at the moment able to do in the numbers, which would lead to the reduction of the use of agencies.
Could I just sort of ask for a bit of focus there as well on what you see as the main barriers to that recruitment?
There are lots of barriers. I think I took part in a project last year called Voices from the Frontline, and I was privileged with colleagues in Scottish Care to interview a number of frontline workers, as you have been privileged to meet them this morning. They, to a man and woman, are dedicated individuals who give of their life to the care and support of individuals. But there are things which would make them think about whether they can continue in their job. And terms and conditions is undoubtedly one of those things, and the fact that from the 1st of October, in most parts of Scotland, we will be able to pay the Scottish Living Wage will go a long way to meet that particular need. But we have other issues in terms of terms and conditions which need to be addressed, training, learning and development. But fundamentally, we also, and I don't think we can escape this reality, we also have to accept that for many individuals, working in care, working with people, is not something that they find attractive. Society, Scotland as a whole, does not value those who work in the care of older people, in my case, but in the care of many other individuals. So even if we attend to the fundamentally important issue of proper terms and conditions, we all collectively need to do a lot more to advance the value of those who care for people, and we don't do that.
Yeah, in a moment, and then Dave. The issue that came up time and time again this morning was about being undervalued, and that was repeated time and again. Ari, sorry.
Yes, thanks, Karina. The barriers specifically, I won't add to what Donald said about recruitment, because I think that's an issue. I mean, more generally, I think the numbers of people who might be required in the future to make this a sustainable sector is quite challenging. The Scottish Government itself came out at one point and said, you know, it won't be very much longer before every single care leaver, every single school leaver is going to have to go into care in order to kind of keep the thing afloat. And I think one of the things that our members are looking at very carefully in relation to that is service redesign, because we can't kind of keep going in and providing care and support in the way that we are, so we need to kind of figure out a different way of doing it. Certainly the voluntary sector, we're very interested in the potential of self-directed support around that. But something else that I would want to add to one of the barriers that the member asked about, and you'll know, convener, that it doesn't take me long to get around to commissioning and procurement of care and support, is the way in which care is commissioned on framework contracts. So, you know, it used to be much more the case that you would, as a provider, you would get a contract for a service with a certain number of hours, with a certain number of people to support, and then you could plan your workforce around that. Increasingly, you are then now accepted onto a framework, so you have no sense of how many people you might have to provide support to in the future, how many hours of support you might have to provide. So in that kind of circumstance, it's very, very difficult to do forward planning for the workforce. So we would like to see not just service redesign, but a redesign of the way that care is commissioned, because I think that's really quite a significant barrier.
Yeah, I mean, I'd largely agree. If you looked at a chance to read our latest survey of care staff, I would guess some of the pretty similar things you'll have heard this morning. The report We Care Do You essentially takes the voices of our frontline care workers and explains what their concerns are. Fundamentally, there simply aren't enough staff. I mean, it's the bottom line is that staff tell you that even when they finish their shift, they get a phone call saying, can you do another case? Can you do another one? And that's difficult itself, or can you squeeze another one in? In other words, bluntly, people who are supposed to get a 30-minute visit get a 20-minute visit because you've got to try and squeeze another visit in that's not been scheduled. Linked very closely to that is the fact that I agree with a lot of travel time is not taken into account in a lot of the programmes, so that in theory a person's getting a 30-minute visit, actually to allow the time to travel they're actually only getting a 20-minute visit. The other big problem is that because of the perceived lack of attractive job prospects in the sector, pay and etc., the turnover is very high in this sector, even among better employers. And I'm not just talking about, you know, the worst in the sector. I've seen turnover rates in some of our better employers of nearly 25%. Now, that's call centre standards, to give you a sort of idea, which is notorious for having high turnover rates. Now, you cannot provide continuity of care, particularly for elderly people, if you're seeing a different carer almost every week, and that is the case. Barriers, paying conditions are important, but you know, we do need to see this as an all workforce issue. One of the points that we made, the Scottish Government's guidance on procurement makes it clear that local authorities should be procuring on all workforce issues. So that's pay, conditions, travelling time, training. All of those things should be taken into account. And frankly, they're not. We also need to remember we need to attract about another 60,000 care workers into the sector in the coming years. Now, if we can't recruit at the moment, where's the next 60,000? I won't dare mention Brexit if you want to get onto that later, because a lot of these workers, you know, are EU nationals, so we've got another issue to face up there. But the reality is that if you talk to people face to face, and I've done a number of focus groups with our members in this area, the older staffs tend to say, well, I'll probably hang on till retirement. The younger staff, and there are spikes in the sector, there is a group in the late 40s, early 50s, and a late 20s, early 30s group. The late 20s, early 30s group say, this is not an attractive job, Dave. If I can get better money stacking shelves in the supermarket, that's where I'm going.
Just a couple people come in first of all. Nikki?
I think there's important things that have been drawn out there. Colleagues earlier referenced nursing and quality and continuity of care, and there's a huge amount of work happening nationally around the review of district nursing, around the out-of-hours review, around the development of clusters, locality working in general practice. And I absolutely agree with what my colleague said around this being a whole workforce issue, around how we will work together, how do we create and make the best use of the skills that everybody has so that we're making best value of the contribution of everybody to meet the needs of people within the community setting.
Ivan.
Just on this, there was a couple of things that were, well, one thing that was raised this morning, which was interesting for me. One of the care workers said that part of the problem is you can be on for a 12 or a 13-hour day, but you're only working for 7 or 8 hours of those. So that does a number of things. It discourages people from staying in the profession when they realise that they could go into a 12-hour shift in ASDA and they get paid for every one of those hours compared to the situation they're in the care home. Clearly, it's a logistics planning issue, which is I know can be challenging, but also it says there's unused capacity there if people are in that situation. So I just wonder if you want to comment on that. And the second on this was on the self-directed support, which I don't know a lot about, and it's interesting you mentioned that, but if you look at that at a macro level, are you not just in a position where you're saying, yeah, we've got a problem, let's move the problem somewhere else? Because at the end of the day, if the individual patient goes and hires somebody to do that job, they're still hiring from the same pool of people that exist to do that kind of work, so you're not actually fixing the root cause of the problem, maybe just moving it to somebody else.
Is anyone
kind of
not... Ivan's just raised there. Just a second, I'll come to you next, Alec, okay? Yeah.
Specifically, I think it's a fair point. I think the thing to understand about self-directed support is it's not necessarily an individual hiring their own personal assistant. There are other things that you can do. You can buy in care from an agency. You can be much more flexible about it. I think where self-directed support starts to raise some questions for me around the issue that you're addressing there is how you can provide personalised care for people who will want to choose when they want support and at what time, and it won't necessarily be at the time that the council wants to send somebody round, and how as an employer you can employ people on fair work principles at the same time as being completely responsive to individuals who don't want it 9 to 5, who don't want it Monday to Friday, who might want support at odd times and then not others. The committee will be aware, I'm sure, of the Fair Work Convention, which has been established to advise the government on fair work principles. And my understanding is that they want to look at this issue very, very specifically around social care, personalisation and fair work and how we actually manage that. So that might be one to watch.
My question is very much to explore further the issues of self-directed support. I think that the vision of SDS was something that gathered cross-party support in terms of service redesign in answering the very real and present sort of threat of the perfect storm, if you like, of the aging demographic, the decline in the workforce, and all the issues we've heard about this morning. I wonder if people around the table, colleagues around the table, could explore how they think SDS is working out, in particular the impact on the commissioning environment, because we heard at the NHS Lothian briefing on Friday that some providers have aggressively gone after recruiting their patients into SDS to avoid commissioning, but also that there is a mixed picture out there as to what's available, so that you may have the choice to take on full control of your budget, but if you've only got a sole provider in a rural region, there's no real point because you'll get the service that you are being provided already.
Can I make an observation? I think you're right,
and the committee will know that SDS did have cross-party support. I personally believe that it has the potential to be amongst the most innovative answers to some of the particular challenges that we're facing, but we're not maximising the opportunities that that legislation gives to us. I think one of the problems is that we talk about SDS here and we talk about social care assessment over there, but there is only one type of assessment for somebody who requires social care support, and that is under the self-directed support legislation. Are we maximising the opportunities of all the four options? No. And is there a piecemeal approach in different parts of the country? Certainly. And for those who I support, what we are seeing is an underuse of self-directed support by our older citizens. There's almost the presumption that what might be additional engagement through planning your own support and life is something for those under the age of 65. That's a very false assumption. We and our members know that lots of older people would like much greater control over the personal budgets, which would enable them to lead increasingly independent lives. So real potential, which we haven't maximised, and it necessitates us, as Annie has said, looking at the way in which we commission and procure services. Because if you commission an organisation to provide a 15-minute or a half-hour support to an individual. That is not going to enable the holistic, person-centred approach which the Act envisioned.
Just asking in relation to self-directed support, whether you think it will close the gap in health inequality or widen the gap, because my view is that it has the potential to widen the gap, and that for certain people, they have no, they wouldn't know how to organise that. They wouldn't have the support, the family support, or the framework around about them to organise that. Therefore, they're not going to do that. They're not going to get that self-directed support advantage that other people may.
I suppose, in essence, the self-directed support legislation was actually the reverse. It was about creating equality of opportunity. So those who were articulate, who had family connection, weren't those who were going to be most advantaged. But if you had a system where people had increased choice, had information around that choice, had support to be able to make that choice, then actually it would lead to better personal outcomes. So I hope I'm not dreaming when I think that it is possible for this legislation to reduce health inequality by giving people the sort of service and support that they really need and which clinically and personally will achieve better outcomes for them. We've got a long way to go, and I think at the moment we've so focused on getting the system of integration right that we've taken our eye off the potential of self-directed support. We need to refocus that attention.
Colin.
Can I come back to the issue of recruitment and retention? It was actually the point that Dr. McCaskill made earlier about the fact that the Scottish Living Wage obviously kicks in from the 1st of October, and I'm keen to get any observations on that process, in particular how that process of introducing the Scottish Living Wage has actually gone, because obviously there's a big requirement for negotiations of commissions and contracts there. So I'm keen to know, has that process gone smoothly? Has the allocation of resources to deliver the Scottish Living Wage been sufficient for providers? And looking beyond the Living Wage, what other ways or specific measures do you think could be introduced to boost recruitment and retention?
I don't think there's one answer to that range of questions. In terms of how's it going, that depends on which part of the country you're in. If we can deal with, for my sector, two different groups, the care home sector, as a result of the National Care Home Contract, every care home in Scotland that certainly who has signed up to the contract will be in a position from the 1st of October to pay staff the Scottish Living Wage. That's been part of that national negotiation process. There have been challenges in that sector. The settlement did not allocate sums, monies to take account of differentials. And that's critically important because if, as you will have heard this morning, we are wanting to create social care as a pathway, as a career of choice, then simply paying and allocating monies to pay the Scottish Living Wage to those at entry level doesn't enable that career to be established. So if you are, as a provider, having to eat into your assets, your training budget, your reserves, which might have gone for further service development, if you're having to eat into that, as they are now, in order to pay enhanced rates to a supervisor or a manager, that's a short-term fix for a fairly fundamental problem. On the other hand, we've got the care at home and housing support sector. Because we are in that system of local commissioning and procurement, the answer to your question depends on which part of the country that you're in. We, I think, in Scottish Care have significant concerns that in a good number of areas in Scotland, we will be in a position on the 1st of October of providers, on the one hand, having to make a choice of reducing terms and conditions just in order to pay the baseline Scottish Living Wage, and in other parts of the country, not being able to pay the Scottish Living Wage because the offer from the local authority and the IJB is such that they will be unsustainable and non-viable. And my concern as a membership organisation is that that challenge is particularly faced for the majority of small, medium enterprise, family-run businesses in Scotland. If you only operate in one area, if your staff base is only in one area, you don't have the economy of scale to balance one area against another, an area which may give you a better
package and deal. And we have, lastly, concerns about approaches which are introducing a percentage uplift. Percentage uplifts sound and look as if they are fair, but they're only equitable if you start from an equal baseline. So if I'm a provider in one local authority area being paid £11 an hour for care and support, and somebody else is being paid £15 an hour, the guy at £15 an hour with a 2 or 3% uplift will be able to pay the living wage without restricting staff conditions in a viable way, but the person at £11 will not. And those £11 folks are our small, medium, high-quality organisations, and I'm profoundly concerned in some parts of Scotland, though the negotiations are ongoing, that that will not be achieved.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on the issue of personal assistance, which, as Annie pointed out, is only one aspect of the self-directed support legislation. But it's in the context of fair work. That group of people, if we're hanging a lot on growing the capacity that we have in personal assistance, then we really have to look at them in the context of fair work, because those people are very, very vulnerable. They're working with people who are vulnerable. Yes, the service users are vulnerable. However, the workers themselves are very, very much, they're not subject to the living wage agreement as many people across, I mean, it's a myth to say it's social services workers that are getting the living wage. It's not, it's very specific workers who are getting the living wage. Anyone working in adult daycare, for example, working with children, they don't get it, or they're not part of this commitment. And personal assistance, I feel, will probably be last in the queue because they're not organised, they're individuals, they're not, well, like much of the workforce, they're not unionised, and therefore they're very vulnerable. So I would worry about them in this context. But also on the question of the living wage, I think that what the point that Donald made earlier about not valuing the workers, I think it's we don't value people who work in care. We don't regard them in the same way that we do teachers or nurses or, you know, other workers, footballers even. How shocking is that? But we also don't value the people that they work with, and I think that's a knock-on effect. We don't value old people particularly in this country. We don't value children particularly in this country. And I think that's a real indictment on our society. But until we can change that, we will not manage to recognise and get people working in the sector, because they need to feel like they're doing a valuable thing. The View From Here work that Iris did last year with the Guardian newspaper was the only time that the Guardian had heard the words joy mentioned in one of their surveys of staff, because the staff that they talked to loved what they did, but they felt exploited. The only people they felt valued by were the people that used their services and the people they worked with, but that brought them joy. But how do we kind of harness that and make that more recognised as part of society, I suppose?
See, that very much reflects what we heard this morning. Ian and then Marie.
Forgive me, but I can only speak on behalf of Aberdeenshire, so it will be quite a parochial approach that I'll take. In terms of the challenges around about the original question about workforce, I think it has a different dynamic in almost every part of Scotland. And I would, you know, like to reflect in terms of Aberdeenshire. You know, we have a very rural geography in Aberdeenshire, and it is incredibly difficult to recruit all types of health and social care staff to a rural environment. And I think the economics of the North East also play into it. We have still a buoyant oil and gas industry, and house prices are still relatively high as well. So it is difficult to attract. I think one of the key points in this is round about how we value staff across health and social care partnerships. And I think that is a fundamental aspect that over a period of time hasn't been addressed properly. We are developing through health and social care integration, properly integrated teams, one team approach, so that health and social care staff, including GPs, actually feel part of a team. And I think for a long period of time, home carers, support workers, these people have been seen out with that team. And I think it's absolutely now the opportunity that we have in Aberdeenshire to draw those individuals into the team and make them feel valued and respected within that environment.
Yeah, I would just say that I heard that from some of the people who we spoke to this morning said exactly that point, and that, that part of the value was relationships. So I'm glad you're doing it that way in Aberdeenshire, and we should all, I keep saying this, we should be looking north. I just wanted to ask about, in terms of valuing staff, I think that I got a sense that that in the caring environment, there's probably more value placed in caring in childcare. There's more training available, there's more regulation, there's more obvious career paths. Is that something that you guys would agree with and would say was an issue as well? And I think in terms of valuing people, like I think providing training is one of the main ways that you invest in staff. So, you know, I'm interested to hear what you think about training and career progression.
So, I mean, I'm a care at home provider, a care at home employer. As a managing director, I actually take 2 days a week to interview frontline care workers. It's the most important part of my job. It's what I spend most of my time doing. And you asked what sort of the was asked earlier on about the barriers to entry, and a lot of the things regarding the acceptance and the importance of the jobs have been discussed. But there's some sort of, for care at home providers, people who are flexible that are mobile, particularly car drivers. Interestingly enough, there's one of the huge barriers to entry for us is people that don't drive. Now, I know it seems like a funny thing, right, but I need people who can drive cars. I also need people who can work what we would term as unsocial hours for weekends and for evenings. What I tell people at interview is we need to provide services when people want services, not when we want to provide services. So there is a limited, see when you look at what we actually need to provide services, it actually starts to limit, irrespective of whether people are actually physically or able to do the job, but it actually limits the choices that you have in a profession in a care at home setting. Other things as a sort of as barriers is we live in a sort of society where it's acceptable to a certain extent, especially in a home setting, where female workers can provide personal care, which is a huge part of our job, to both male and female service users. And that's not the case necessarily for male workers. So there is an imbalance built into the numbers in absolute terms. So it's not like when I look at my workforce planning, I will take on 50-50 particularly. It would be a much higher amount of women entering the workforce. So you can see the types of whittling down of the people that we can actually do. The care, the £8.25, the minimum wage, I see as a start and actually could be transformational within our industry. I think it, you know, as long as that is the starting point and there's progression within an organisation, I think that could begin to reflect the importance of the job at the care worker.
Anna.
To address your point about the comparative levels of training and regulation, there's actually more regulation of workers in the social service workforce than there is in the care sector, because we regulate everyone who works in care homes at the moment. All the managers across social services are regulated, and the care at home workforce is coming on from next year. And to be on our register, you have to have minimum qualifications. So they must, and you have time to get the qualifications, but over the course of time, and currently we're going through this with people working in care homes, everyone will have to get minimum qualifications. All the managers, and they're doing that just now, all the managers already have to have management qualifications. So I think there is a difference, and how people experience the training that they get, especially in care at home at the moment, will vary across the country, but there are actually minimum standards and minimum requirements that they do have to meet.
Can I just follow on from that?
Just a second, Donald. Carry on if it's a follow-on.
Just very quickly.
We are increasingly making social care a career of choice. And into the future, there is absolutely tremendous opportunity. If we're going to meet the needs of the National Clinical Strategy, the out-of-hours strategy, if we're going to meet all that lies potentially with integration, then we're going to have staff needing in the community and in care homes to be upskilled to develop increased capacity and ability. So there is a potential for positive careers in care, but we need to give all the value, both in terms of conditions and other elements of service.
I think
I think all of us would agree the potential was there, but from the evidence that we heard this morning, we're a long, long way from that. Annie?
To come back on a couple of points, the member here. I'll lodge with the committee our benchmarking HR report from the voluntary sector providers, and one of the encouraging things in that was that voluntary sector providers are very committed to training and development, and nearly 70% of the providers we surveyed had actually managed to keep their development and training budget stable or had increased it. And that has been not without its struggles, but if you're looking to develop a workforce to make it an attractive career, yeah, you absolutely have to invest in that, and in our sector we've kind of placed quite a high priority on that. I just wanted to come back to the living wage question, convener, if I may, briefly. I mean, you'll know that my organisation has campaigned for this for a very long time. I think we've probably led the debate on this over the years by producing evidence about the impact of pay and conditions on quality, and we were absolutely delighted when this initiative was announced back in February. If I'm honest, I'd have to say we were less delighted that we read about it in the paper, rather than actually being involved in some of the decision-making around it. So providers weren't involved in the decisions about the amount of resource, and we weren't involved in the setting of dates around implementation. And so at this point, we are struggling to get over the bar. I think a lot of providers are confident that they'll make it, but there are some challenges, and Donald set them out. I mean, part of the challenge was that the resource that was allocated didn't account for differentials within organisations, which is huge if you're talking about career progression and development. But it also didn't include on-costs for employers, so national insurance, pension contributions. And there was an assumption that providers would find a contribution to make to this. And certainly in the not-for-profit sector, that is something which we are really struggling with. To be honest, we are working through these issues now with partnerships. We're working with COSLA, with Scottish Government, Donald and I around the table, Unison around the table. But I wouldn't say that it was easy. We took some soundings from our members on the 1st of September, kind of with 1 month to go, and the majority of them were thinking, really, we're struggling to arrive at appropriate funding agreements, because as the committee has heard, this money was allocated through local authorities and integrated joint boards in order to then to contract locally with providers. We certainly advocated a national approach that wasn't taken forward, and we advocated an approach which was less about the amount of money that went into staff pockets, because that's something that employers need to deal with. We advocated an approach which was about how much we pay for public services, and therefore what is the enabling factor that allows providers to pay the living wage, and that wasn't taken forward either. So there are some hurdles to overcome. I think we'll be taking some more soundings over the coming weeks, but we're hopeful and yet cautious.
Ivan?
Yeah, can I first of all do a couple of questions, right? Firstly, on training, I think it's absolutely right, that's key. I'd have to say our experience is it's a bit patchy in places. I'm particularly concerned about induction training in home care areas. I frequently get examples, frankly, universities ringing up when their daughter or sons have been started work and are not given adequate induction before being sent out into fairly complicated care areas. Also, refresher training, ongoing training, CPD, very often staff tell us that they're told to do that in their day off. Which is not, frankly, the way it should happen. So there are issues there. I think the point about rural areas is well made. I was talking to a social worker last week who said she rang five providers to try and provide a package for an elderly person needing hospital. And several of the providers said, we don't do villages, as a response. And I should say this was a rather rural local authority. So she wasn't much impressed by that either. But I think it does reflect some of the challenges, in fairness to providers, in terms of getting getting people out, and of course travelling time is a huge issue there. If I can address Colin's question, I largely agree with Annie's response. Let's be very clear, we welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to the 8.25 living wage from the 1st of October. I think it's absolutely the right policy. I think the difficulty has been in the delivery of that. We were told £250 million was allocated in the budget for social care. Difficulty, we weren't told how that's broken down, how much was for living wage, how much was for building capacity and so forth. So I think there was that problem. The other concern we have is if you put too much focus on the Scottish living wage, then frankly some of the worst providers in the area will try and cut other terms and conditions to do that. So they'll meet the headline, yes, Minister, we're paying £8.25 an hour, but they'll cut travelling time, they'll charge the mobile phones, they won't pay holiday pay properly, sleepovers, a whole range of issues where they'll tuck terms and conditions. And frankly, our survey, our FOI in our latest survey to councils indicate they didn't even, most of them weren't admitted they weren't following the Scottish Government's statutory guidance in this area, just said, oh, no, we're not following it. So that's a real area of concern. The solution, frankly, if the government had said, look, we accept government in the current climate is not going to have all the money to solve all the problems in the social care sector. But if they'd come, say, in April and said and got ourselves, the providers, COSLA and everyone else around the table and said, look, this is the money, we'll be absolutely transparent what it is, this is what we want to deliver, let's have a discussion about how to deliver that, we would have all played ball with that. We wouldn't be in this, are we going to make it by the 1st of October situation that everybody is in at present. And I do think that involves a national rate for home care. We've got one for the residential sector. I think we should have one for the home care sector as well. So that requires early engagement, transparency about funding, and it also means recognising, as Unison's Ethical Care Charter, which a number of authorities are now picking up, recognise you've got to do a range of things. Pay is very important, but there are other things you've got to do as well. So I think if we had a national forum to do this, that would allow local authorities, the integrated joint boards, remember the money didn't go to councils, it went into the health service and then into IJBs and then into councils, which seems the most bizarre way of funding anything. So if we actually had that transparent system, I think that would allow the IJBs to focus on designing the best system, the best service delivery, service design issues locally without having to worry about the key issues in terms of contractual rates.
Yeah, just to go back and touch on the integration aspect of it, one of the things that was raised this morning by the care workers was the difficulty they found in coordinating and getting responses from other people that were involved in the process. One example was a doctor will come in, make an assessment, write up some notes, but they never tell us, so we have no idea what the status of the patient is, or getting a hold of other staff in other, other parts. So that's clearly an issue they identified. I don't know if you wanted to comment on that. And I don't know if there's an issue there about different types of provider, be it local authority or ALIO or voluntary sector or private sector, that I don't know if that makes a difference in that view or not. The other thing, just to put in there, a different question, was just inquire about measures of patient satisfaction that are in operation and how those are tracked and what those show.
Can I come in just on the multidisciplinary dimension?
And that is that we're continually speaking to staff both in care homes and at care home services who struggle to have that sense. It comes back to our issue of value. If your role and contribution to the health and well-being of the individuals you're supporting is not being valued by clinical colleagues in the community, whether they're general practitioners, allied health professionals or others, then that is going to have a profound impact on the individual who is receiving that care and support. And let's be honest, we've got a piecemeal level of support, particularly for older individuals. I read a brief summary report this morning about how poor post-diagnostic support is for individuals with dementia in care homes. We're getting it right in the community, we're not getting it right for individuals within the care home sector. So we need to, if we're serious about integration and about valuing our unique contribution as social care staff, as clinical professionals, then we need to not just start talking to each other, not just be co-located, not just have teams, networks or whatever, but we need to start collaborating around the person who doesn't ultimately care what the colour of the uniform you are wearing is, but what difference you make to her life. And at the moment, because of a lack of interprofessional support, that's not happening.
Can I return to the question about training? Because some of the care workers I spoke to this morning were almost saying that they were almost undertaking a community nurse role in the job they do, with stoma bags, feeding, and managing medication, things like that. And I think with an increasing palliative care and end of life group of clients, how is training being developed ahead of that, given the demographics we're going to face as a country? I'd be interested to hear any of that ongoing workforce training and upskilling.
Yeah, sorry, Nikki.
I think that's a really important point. I think in terms of joint training, there's a lot now happening where people are developing and delivering training together. Some of what you refer to do not require registered nurses to deliver. And I think when we look at delivering more complex care in the community, whether it be in place of acute hospital care, whether it be palliative care, we need to be ensuring that nurses are able to be delivering what only nurses can deliver. But actually there's a support network there so that people are not feeling dumped on, left, or anything else, and we are working together. I think there's a real role in terms of the development of clusters, the development of local teams, and what is within a locality. And actually, what does that mean for nursing, for allied health professionals, for general practice, for our social care workforce, and for our voluntary independent agencies in that area? Some examples of how I have seen that work in practice is a daily huddle, where general practice would be saying there's a huge amount of data available to us around people who are at risk that we could be using. And actually, what does that mean about being fluid with the workforce that we can have, so we can put the care to where people need it most? There's examples where a social care member of staff may be delivering and supporting care four times a day, who would notice that somebody's pressure areas are becoming red, who can then contact the nurse, who can get involved earlier, so we can really be getting upstream and preventing rather than reacting what's happening. But I think there are examples whereby nurses are almost absorbing things that don't require them to do, but I absolutely agree there's a training need, there's a support need, there's a governance need around making that safe for everybody.
A couple of things we heard this morning, we were speaking to some of them, were telling us the new technology that they've been using, where they get care plans on a smartphone and all the rest of it, and that's great. Others are saying that they get a text from a manager that means that they no longer have any interaction with another person in the organisation. So there are huge advantages with technology, but other disadvantages as well. Alec, then Claire.
Donald first. I'm not quite sure who's best to answer this, but the committee has given itself the task of examining the implications of the Brexit vote. And I think at this stage, it would help to find out what estimate you can put on the percentage of EU nationals working in the social care workforce, firstly, and secondly, is there any great divergence in terms of geography or the independent or internal structures? That would help. I don't know who can answer this, David. I know you mentioned it.
Yeah, I mean, I did mention it. It's interesting. After the day after the referendum, I thought we better find out how many staff we've got who are EU nationals, how many members, I did and got my team working on all the usual sources, and you very quickly discovered there isn't any data, and we don't know. There is, for example, in the NHS, a survey of ethnicity, essentially, but it's voluntary. And large chunks of staff choose not to answer it. You might be worried as to why they feel they don't not able to answer that survey, but the sad fact is that they don't. So we don't really know that. We've done some work ourselves. We reckon we've got about 6,000 members in Scotland who are EU nationals. And they are mostly in the health and care sector. The bulk of them, I have to say, are largely in the private nursing sector. They're mostly Donald's areas there. We have an overseas nurses group, so I meet quite a lot of them doing that area. So the honest answer is we don't know. But what we do know is they're a large chunk of that group. I remember, you know, working in Scottish Government's Health Department doing workforce planning, the sort that Annie was referring to some years ago. And then we were talking about having to essentially bring almost every young person, certainly women, the girls coming into the area. It didn't happen. That's because migration took up the slack. The next big jump, 60,000 places in health and care, it's not just social care, that's health care as well. They're just not going to be available. You know, the simple demographics tell us that not enough young people are going to A, be there, B, want to work in this sector. So without that level of migration, I just don't know what we're going to do. So it's a real concern for us under Brexit that, first of all, what we said to the Scottish Government, we said to your colleagues on the External Relations Committee, is that we need absolute commitment from the UK government that existing EU nationals must be allowed to stay. Unequivocally say it now, because otherwise people will start to make alternative plans and go. And secondly, we need a long-term arrangement whereby we can still recruit and retain staff from overseas, because we're going to need them.
Can I just add to that, because it is predominantly within the independent sector that many of the European nationals are working. Our last data is about 9 months ago. We're currently undergoing some research, and hopefully that will be available in the next few weeks. With a vacancy level of between 18 and 20% for nurses in the care the independent care sector, over the last 18 months, we've noted that about 55% of recruitment has come from the European community. We've seen major care home organisations and smaller organisations set up recruitment units in European cities. So we have proportionately around about 14 to 16% of our workforce, of our membership, which is the largest social care workforce, who would call Europe, or who were born in Europe. Now, we are confident, because of the hospitality of our country, that we will encourage those who are here to stay and to find a place of value and welcome. But that, as Dave said, doesn't answer the question of how are we going to plug the gap which has been in existence already and which will only grow in the future. And migration seems to us to be the only answer to that question.
Take Alec, then Claire, then Ian.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. My question speaks to Dave Watson's very eye-opening anecdote about the "we don't do villages" comment, and it's about the urban-rural split in terms of social care provision. When I worked for a social care provider before becoming an MSP, we did a bit of work with Angus and identified that there was only 104 children in the whole of that authority who had been assessed to require respite support, which, if you think about it, means that that becomes a very difficult business case for a new provider looking to expand into the area. That has a knock-on effect for choice in terms of self-directed support, as we discussed earlier. But also it has other implications in terms of travel times around rural areas that, you know, if you've got an hour window to fill, to meet somebody and to support them, it may take you 25 minutes, half an hour to get there. I wonder if our panellists could reflect on that and tell us how, if there are solutions to this, or how they see that problem developing.
I think there are solutions, and we're seeing some. I would agree. I think we need to look north, and in the Highlands, in particular around Inverness, there are some innovative programs in Bullaskin where community groups have, with the support of one of our members, Highland Home Carers, have begun to develop alternative models, in that case a workers' cooperative and a community-led model, to provide social care support in some of our more rural and isolated communities, and have been enabled to do so with the support of NHS Highland and Highland council. So where there is collective partnership working, then we're coming up with the solutions to the challenge. Where there is not, then the challenges only grow.
Clear.
Thank you, Convener, and I want to declare an interest in that I'm a member of Unison. One of the issues that was raised with me this morning was the use of zero-hour contracts within particularly home care. This wasn't a short-term measure for covering holidays or vacancies. This was staff who were employed on a continual basis on zero-hour contracts who were also expected to do training in their own time unpaid. What I would like to ask is, how can social care providers justify this on a long-term basis? And also, what work are the IJBs at NHS doing to ensure that anyone who is contracted to an IJB is not using exploitative zero-hour contracts?
I personally, as an organisation, we don't use zero-hour contracts at all. We have 320 staff. We contract all our staff. It's possible to do. There is a price to pay in that, and it actually falls on to the question that Ivan had said earlier on about it spread out during the day, and it's a bit about workforce planning as well. So how we're contracted by local authorities, they've hollowed out the services a little bit. So a lot of services in the morning, a lot of services in the evening, not so much in the middle. So that has changed quite significantly in the last 4 or 5 years, and that does mean for people to get full-time hours, people are working split shift, and that's, you can explain, that's just a fact of life at the moment. But you can guarantee hours to do that, as to your point. What you have to do is, you know, it does take a lot of planning to do that. You have to be confident you're going to get the work. You also have to, someone mentioned earlier on about attaching certain service users to a particular worker, for example. We find that difficult to do. The way things are contracted at the moment, because if somebody goes into hospital, somebody loses all their hours. So it has to be a little bit more spread out, so that if somebody goes into hospital, they don't lose all their hours, kind of thing. So it just takes a little bit of thought, a little bit of planning to do. But it is possible to do. We've done it. We've always done it that way, and for a lot of people. So it is possible to do, but it just takes a little bit of time to do that.
So in relation to that, those two issues in relation to 0 hours and living wage. Previously, we were told that it was rules, EU rules, single market rules, that type of thing that was preventing that becoming in as, you know, as statutory. Is that the case? Was that the case? And might that change?
I mean, I think there's two points here. Firstly, I think if you look at the official statistics, would tell you that there's probably less than 10% in the sector on 0 hours contracts. Actually, that grossly underestimates the problem. And the reason is because there are a lot of people on what I would call nominal hour contracts. In other words, which rather under, so it's not that you're on 0 hours. What you get is a 10-hour contract or a 15-hour contract, but actually you regularly work 20 and 25. So, and that's equally as big a problem for someone in terms of getting a mortgage, in terms of getting those sort of working out your career, and puts off people working in the sector, no doubt about it. That does lead to the point that Arden raised about split shifts. You know, we do find that it's one thing if you've got a three-hour split shift in the morning and a three-hour one in the evening and a big gap in between. You can go home, you can do other things. Frankly, some of our members even do other jobs in between. It's another thing altogether if it drags on till 12 and your next shift, inverted commas, is at 2 o'clock. You haven't got time to go home, so you just walk into cafes and, you know, all sorts of places around Scotland, you will see an awful lot of care workers. In fact, we even organise and do recruitment exercises in supermarkets, because you can actually see care workers with their uniforms going around supermarkets in the coffee shops, because they're cheap, just wasting time, frankly, on that basis. In terms of procurement, there's been lots of myths around this. The procurement guidance that we agreed with the Scottish Government shows how to do this, and it's really disappointing that local authorities seem to struggle to actually follow it. It's not ideal. We'd like it to be very clear, specify the living
living wage. That's it. In our view, that can be done perfectly legally. For all sorts of reasons, the law officers felt that wasn't possible. It is possible under the new guidance. All that simply has to happen is the local authority specifies in its general strategy, its policy on procurement, what it wants to see. Living wage, secure contracts, time to care, etc., etc. All of those things, it can specify our care charter in there. Then it can evaluate contracts against it. And once you award the contract, essentially the contractor's agreeing to deliver that. So it's a bit messy, it's a bit complicated, but it's legal and it's doable, and it's beyond understanding, frankly, as to why local authorities say they can't follow it.
Annie, on that point.
Thanks, Convener. I think the question is a really interesting one. I mean, I think the key to it is exploitative zero-hours contracts in the kind of sports direct fashion. I think there are very few, if any, voluntary organisations that operate those as a general kind of package of terms and conditions for staff. Where zero-hours contracts can be very useful with the agreement of staff is for relief and sessional staff. And a lot of organisations will be operating it in cooperation with their own staff around that. But by and large, the kind of thing that you're talking about doesn't really exist in the voluntary sector. The Fair Work comments that Dave has made are absolutely crucial, I think, and to the point. What we found in some tender exercises for social care is that the Fair Work question is there for bidders to answer, and the weighting given to that in the tender evaluation is 5%. You know, whereas the cost is 30 or 40%. And I think that's where we need to see some change. Much more weight given to Fair Work principles and practice in tenders. And just coming back to Donald's point previously about some of the community-based alternatives to getting an infrastructure of a provider into a village, which is very difficult and actually very costly. The minute you tender for that, you'll kill it. That would be my view. And certainly, when we started talking about Brexit within our own membership, it wasn't the EU national workforce that came up first. It was, does this mean we can follow different rules around procurement now? Because people really, really want that to happen.
Sorry, you've been waiting some time.
Just to follow up on a point that was made earlier regarding communication between a GP and a carer, just in that instance. I think that's... a lot of that's just based around about the historical construct of multidisciplinary teams, and in many ways quite silo based. And I think we have an opportunity now to, and we are pursuing that opportunity to look at why does a carer have to go to their manager, then relays information to another manager, who then relays it to another person, and it just doesn't seem that sensible to have that approach. So. We're moving to a very much a location team approach, where carers are part of that team, and that's it's called a virtual community ward. So the practitioners gather together every morning with a whiteboard of folk in their local village or town that they're concerned about, and the GPs are involved in that as well, and they go through that list of people. And there's feedback given, and they come off the list if need be, or they add other people on. And it's not a health model, it's not a social care model, it's a joint model. Everybody's respected within that team, and their views and opinions are all exactly equal in there. And I think that, you know, through that approach, we break down some of those barriers of elitism that often creeps into the multidisciplinary way of working.
In terms of your organisation, what are they doing in relation to 0 hours? And do they operate within your area?
So I can only speak on behalf of the Health and Social Care Partnership in Aberdeenshire. I think what broadly happens is that we in the past had very fixed rotas, and I think that it didn't necessarily suit many people in terms of a family-friendly approach. So we have a range of shift patterns that now operate and a range of contracts that operate as well. But most of them are based around about a set number of hours. There is also relief staff as well that are part of that mix of staff. However, demand outstrips supply. So if people want a certain amount of hours, broadly they are given that number of hours. So it's as I say, it's very much based on around about the demand, which is increasing all the time, and we do struggle to meet that demand.
Can I make an observation about
zero-hour contracts? Obviously, our 60% of our providers struggle to recruit staff. You don't enter into an exploitative situation if you're wanting to recruit staff. Employers in social care, by and large, don't establish themselves to be poor employers. But it comes completely back to the Fair Work Practice process that both Dave and Annie have talked about. We will only ultimately get fair work conditions if we get a fair process of commissioning and procurement, and that ultimately involves us all, as Dave has suggested, sitting around the table and saying, what does it cost to give not basic but appropriate high quality care and support to our citizens? And that involves a national process, and it's about time, because the sector, the workers in the sector, the managers and those who are providers are getting tired of constantly in different parts of the country negotiating 5 pence here, 10 pence there, 16 pence somewhere else. It's time for us, if we're serious about, in my sector, older people care and support, for us to get round the table within our limited resource and start negotiating about what does that look in practice.
Richard, then Claire.
Donald McCaskill actually has just touched on the very point I was going to bring, and I do apologise to anyone who may take offence of what I'm going to ask, but it's a question that's not been asked yet. Previously, all care was done by councils, council staff, you know, people run council homes. Then we privatised it all, and everything supposedly got better. We've got private care homes, private care at home, agency workers. We don't get into villages because, you know, we don't do that. Have we privatised care too much? Have we got to a situation where we really need to bring it back under scale? And sorry to say it, gentlemen and ladies, renationalise it, bring it back, you know, because I've watched care workers from different agencies in my street get into different houses. Different agencies get into the same street, you know. So, you know, and with the greatest respect to private providers complaining about wages and conditions and holidays and whatever, they make a profit. They're in it to make a profit. So should we not do what you're saying, Donald, to do away with all these factors of 5 pence or whatever here and there, to bring it back all back under the one umbrella rather than all the separate umbrellas that we presently are?
Can I respond to
that, given that, you know, as the representative organisation of the independent, which includes private, charitable and not-for-profit, I think what we're wanting is a range of choice for citizens, so that if I want to choose provider A, who's offering a particular skill set, or provider B, whether that's public, private, independent, or charitable and voluntary. So I think that's what we're ultimately as citizens desiring. But have we given sufficient resource to the sector? No. In the last 10 years, year on, year in, we have reduced per capita the amount of money allocated to the care and support of older citizens. And that has a profound impact on the nature and the quality of the services delivered. So fundamentally, the picture, the question is bigger, not who does it, but what is it that we want people to do? What is the level of care and support that we're requiring? Because eligibility criteria keep getting higher. And the old 20, 30 years ago home help, who fundamentally connected people up to their communities, has gone. And now, as we've already heard, we've got individuals engaged in high, intensive, emotionally draining work. You know, I was going to come back on the palliative care comment about, are we ready for the palliative end of life needs of our community? And in some areas, yes. But in other areas, the person who sits with somebody in their last few weeks in life is terrified because she or he is not trained or not resourced, because their organisation can't afford it. So we do need to get round the table. I don't think one answer is going to be the solution, but we need to, at the very least, to start talking.
Can I ask how many providers there have been in the last 20 years? Have it doubled, quadrupled, or stayed the same?
That's roughly when we started. And it started an interesting thing. At that time, there was home helps who didn't do much personal care. And district nurses, just at that time, stopped giving things that they called at that time a medical bath and didn't give a social bath, but only gave a medical bath. And right at that, and they asked nursing homes, care homes, to go out into the community and provide medical baths. That's actually, or social baths, sorry. That's how a lot of care at home providers, including ourselves, started, funnily enough, around about that time in the mid-90s. So that's how that a lot of our industry actually started, was a change in how the nursing in the community did and what the home helps could do at that particular time.
Okay, Tom?
Okay. One of the things that we've touched on many, many times is how we value our care staff. Particular issues have been raised about parity of esteem within the multidisciplinary environment, but it goes deeper. My question is sort of very short. It concerns the welfare of care staff themselves. Who cares for carers? Because it was struck me in the conversations I was very privileged to have this morning, the number of carers who just feel on the edge of breaking down, overwhelmed. So I would just like to ask, do we know how many days are lost to stress, to depression? Do we know how many of our carers have been prescribed antidepressants? How many are battling with alcohol problems? Because these are some of the issues that were directly raised to me this morning, and I'd like to hear some comments.
Just very quickly, we have run a project called the Frontline Worker Project for the last 2 years.
It has over 100 frontline workers. They developed their programme, and next week we're holding a day in which we will look with them at the emotional, personal and physical well-being of home care and care home staff, because they said, just as you have rightly identified, that this is a hard, joyful job which we enjoy, but it's increasingly tiring and draining. And all that relates to everything we've talked about this morning. We, if we're going to hold on to these dedicated individuals, do need to attend to their health and well-being, and we all need to start doing that together. Next week in Glasgow, we're beginning that process.
Yeah, it's actually really difficult to achieve what you're asking for. The only way at the moment to do it is through things like Donald's saying, where you have focus groups and you have samples and you have surveys and you extrapolate up from that, because what you're looking at is a sector with over 7,000 employers. So it's not like you can just kind of go out to 32 councils or 14 health boards or whatever and say, tell us the stats for your staff. There's actually thousands of employers, and they are the ones that will hold the information. So it's really hard to achieve, but you can do it in that kind of sampling type of way.
Annie, then, Claire.
Just again, from our HR benchmarking survey from the voluntary sector, the average number of days lost per employee was 9.9. Economy as a whole is 8.3, and actually the figure was lower than the last time we checked it. Now, how much of that is down to the kinds of issues you're talking about, I can't say, but those are some sort of stats that I put before the committee. Convener, can I just come back on the member's point about privatisation? Hesitate to correct a member. But I have to say that everything was not always provided by councils. A lot of care and support has always been provided by voluntary organisations. It's just that the public sector caught up with us eventually and decided to fund it publicly. So I think the issue that we've got here is, you know, whether things are provided by a mixed economy or not is a matter of perhaps political taste. But what I can tell you is, in the voluntary sector, the quality of care and support provided by the voluntary sector for adults in Scotland is much higher than either the private or the public sector. So if we're actually looking at the service that people get, there is a very good justification for actually putting more out into the voluntary sector rather than taking it back in-house again. And just quickly to talk about the kinds of support that staff are getting for the sort of issues that you have. Donald was talking earlier about the risk of living wage implementation, that people will end up with £8.25 in their pocket, but other things will be cut in order to pay for it. One of the things that we're very, very concerned about in relation to that is supervision. Supervision for staff, because this is, you know, even if you're not doing extra hours or overtime, you know, it's a very challenging job at the best of times, whether you have Fair Work principles or you don't. So the importance of good management and supervisory support is critical. And we certainly wouldn't want to see that sacrificed in pursuit of some kind of totemic achievement of a number somewhere.
Okay, so Alec.
Just very quickly on the back of Annie's point, I should have declared at the start that the social care provider I worked with was Abelard. There is empirical evidence to show that service provision in the voluntary sector can outstrip the statutory provision we have. For example, in looked after children, those who are in residential care in the voluntary sector have demonstrably better educational attainment and attendance. So I think that rich tapestry of provision is absolutely vital. And also in terms of the procurement environment, when services go out to tender, voluntary sector providers often competing against in-house local authority providers who can hide some of their own costs in terms of the economies of scale they get from being so big. So there, I would absolutely echo what Annie Gunnar Logan was saying about the importance of a rich tapestry.
Alison, then Dave.
I think this is obviously a very, very challenging issue, and you know, we're learning a great deal this morning about the challenges we face, ensuring that we have enough people delivering care. And I'd just like to sort of explore, I think Ian, you mentioned elitism sometimes, part of a multidisciplinary team. One of the groups I spoke with this morning felt that while GPs may engage well with them on a professional level, often they felt overlooked, undervalued, despite the fact they are the person who has spent most time that week with that patient. But the Scottish Social Services Coalition report that there's a steady decline in registration and certification for SPQ health and social care. Apparently, the Social Care Sector 2015 report shows that there is a decline in registration for SVQ training. Now, obviously, if we're looking at a culture here that appreciates and values those working in social care, are we investing enough in their training? When I heard from two people who were working for a private provider this morning who said they had 3 days training, and clearly the better training that we can ensure that all those working in this field have, the more able they will be to deal with what is clearly a stressful and demanding role. So just like a bit of, you know, some of your views on how well we're doing training staff in this area.
Come in.
Just a little bit on that point there about the SSS's data, is what we think on that is that it's because most people have got the qualification now, so the people working in the sector had time to get it. So it's not that there's people aren't doing training, it's they've already met the registration requirements. So that will gradually, that'll go right back to the beginning again with care at home when we get to opening the register for them in 2017. But for people working in care homes, they've had considerable time now to actually achieve those qualifications.
Okay, Alison.
Maybe someone as well could pick up on whether or not agency staff are trained to the same specifications.
Okay, I'm going to take the final two people, Dave and Ian, and then we'll have a kind of sum up.
Yeah, I mean, to pick up on the point about stress, again, if you read our latest survey, there are a number of staff who describe in their own words the pressure they feel under. Increasingly, an awful lot of home care staff also dealing with end-of-life situations for which they're certainly not trained and they've had very little experience in dealing with. I think the response from employers is mixed. The best employers we've been working with doing quite a lot of work on ill health, on sickness absence. In fact, part of the cost reduction has been to try and focus on that and actually been very successful. I have to say in other although the one area actually that this sector is very poor on is dealing with violence at work. Too many employers, I have to say, and I've heard chief exec, one of the biggest providers, say, oh, well, that's part of the job. I'm sorry, it isn't part of the job. And so we have a real problem with violence. The other issue in relation to the worst providers is if you talk to care staff, they'll say, we go to work when we're not well. Because we feel we will be penalised if we don't. And you know, obviously, going to an elderly person when you're not well is not a clever practice, to put it mildly. Equally, you find those, particularly those on zero-hour contracts or nominal-hour contracts, they are the least likely not to go to work when they're not well. And I also have to say they're also the least likely to report safety issues, and they're also the least likely, I'm sad to say, and I was shocked when I asked the question, I didn't plan to. I said, well, what about if you saw carer abuse in the home? Would you report that? And one member of staff said to me, no, Dave, I would not. My manager wouldn't thank me for it because they'd have to do something about it. And because of the fragmented market, they just feel they just go to another provider. So I think there are big issues in the sector. I think the best employers in the sector are trying to tackle this. Frankly, there are people at the lower end of the market who are not tackling it, and there are real problems to be addressed.
I would just like to follow up on it was really Jim's point about how I suppose health and social care has developed over the last 20, 30 years. And the demographics show that there are a lot of people who are more mature, who are being cared for at home. Many of these people are receiving end of life care, have conditions such as motor neuron disease, dementia, and that places a huge, puts a lot of pressure on carers, practitioners, doctors, all of the multidisciplinary team, and you know, it can be quite it can be quite difficult caring for people in their own environment. That's absolutely the right thing to do, but in terms of how we support those individuals, I think that's absolutely critical, and how we support the practitioners and professionals around about that. I think we do that through support and supervision. We do that through having really a strong team ethos, doing debriefs, these sorts of things. But I think if we overlook that part of it, we put far too much pressure on the individuals that are out there providing this care.
Okay, thanks very much. I think maybe just to kind of finish up, we might do a quick quiz round our guests this morning. And, you know, we will be producing a report or a letter to the government on following this short session and our evidence for people this morning. So we're kind of looking for your top line on what we should be saying in that. And maybe, you know, I'm sure everybody's got a, may not have a different view, but, you know, people will have different views as to what we should be saying in that report or that letter that we send forward. So you've got 30 seconds or a minute or so each to tell us what we should be putting in. And if... Anna, do you want to start?
Thank you. I'm for once glad to start, because I'm going to say what everyone else will probably say, which is we need to value the workforce. We need to value them. Not the living wage can't be our highest aspiration. It's got to be a starting point, but it's more than money, and we have to value the people that those people work with as well.
Ian?
Yeah, I think it would just be to reinforce that Scotland has a varied geography. We're one of the most rural parts, but I don't think it's a one-size-fits-all with us. I think integration of social care and that push towards location focus, local villages, towns, communities is absolutely right. Working alongside community planning is essential, and communities and third sector, all of these things is incredibly important in this. And I think ultimately we have to have staff that feel valued, that are resilient, that are well trained, all of these things that have been spoken about already.
Ali.
You know, I think it would be really good for the committee. I know we've talked about problems this morning, but I think it would be good for the committee to look at what people do get out of this area of work, because it's very substantial. And I think when we are looking at the problems that we've examined, my plea would be that we emphasise that market mechanisms and a buyer-supplier relationship for care will not solve our workforce issues, and that partnership and getting all partners around the table in the way that Donald and Dave were talking about is our best hope.
Nikki?
I think that it's about valuing and, I guess, a strength and assets-based approach. Our biggest assets are our workforce. It's about valuing our workforce as that, but also about the diversity of people's needs. People don't come in a box. They're not just an older person. That they're, you know, it's not just mental health. There's learning disability. There's palliative care and frailty. And I think it's about that whole team approach and using the assets of everybody within that team to provide support to our workforce and to ensure we're focusing our care on people that need it in the place in which they need it.
Dave.
Unsurprisingly, care is not delivered by robots, it's delivered by people. And therefore, workforce is the key to this. That means proper paying conditions, it means training, and most importantly, it means giving them the time to care. If you read the surveys, that's what staff say. I want the time to care to get the feedback. The organisational thing we'd ask you to say is a national sectoral framework for care. The Fair Work Convention recommended that we should have more sectoral collective bargaining in Scotland. The Scottish Government accepted that. This is the sector where most of the money comes from the Scottish Government, so it's the easiest to deliver. If we did one structural thing going forward, is to create that framework.
Donald?
It's the words of somebody I spoke to a few weeks ago who was brought up in care, and she said, this is a pure, dead, brilliant job because I get to give back. I love my job. I love what I do. It's just a pity I get embarrassed when I go out on a Saturday night and I tell people that I work in a care home and I used to work at home care, that they feel, what does that? They don't value me. I want a wee bit more money, not a lot, but I want people to value me for what I do.
Okay. Jim?
I think that this is a watershed. I'm incredibly positive. After all the negative things that I've said, I'm incredibly positive. This is a watershed moment. Two things are happening. We've got £8.25 for the living wage going to be introduced. I see that's a starting point. It's changing from being a job to being a career. The registration with the SSSC in early 2017 sort of speaks to getting the qualifications, the SVQ2 qualifications within our workforce. So these two things going together, in my opinion, changes the whole dynamics of things going forward. And we should celebrate what our industry is. The rewards are beginning to get a little bit better for people. The training is going to be much more formalised. And the feedback we get from people who undertake the SVQ is incredibly positive and empowering for them. It gives them a lot more confidence, actually. So I'm actually really quite positive about it, as long as we can build from here.
Okay, thanks very much to everybody for coming in this morning. Greatly appreciated. And we'll now suspend the meeting to change the panel. Okay, our second item on the agenda today is consideration of a public petition, PE1477, by Jamie Ray on behalf of the Throat Cancer Foundation on the human papillomavirus HPV immunisation programme in Scotland. Members are aware of the previous work carried out by the Public Petitions Committee on this petition. The Scottish Government have agreed to implement a targeted extension of the HPV vaccine to include men who have sex with men up to the age of 45 who attend a GUM and HIV clinic. They have also advised that they would not propose extending the HPV programme to adolescent boys ahead of any recommendation of the JCVI that the JCVI may make, and this recommendation is expected in 2017. The committee is going to look at the way in which we handle petitions, given the number of new members and more experienced members who would like to be involved in that discussion around how the committee handles petition. So with the committee's agreement, we will leave the petition sitting with us until we have that further discussion. Can we get agreement on that?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And we now move into private session and suspend the meeting.